when Satoshi Nakamoto, the guy that invented Bitcoin, and let me put his name down here, because when somebody is this revolutionary, we need to give them credit for it, okay? Now, a lot of people say that that Satoshi Nakamoto, let me spell that correctly here. So a lot of people say that they don't know who he is because he's nobody knows, okay? And after he invented this, he released it to the world and no one ever heard about him again, okay? A lot of people say that it's a CIA job or an NSA job or some Secret Service job or FBI or government project Bitcoin is, okay? I really don't care about none of that, okay? All I care about is that what it's gonna do to revolutionize and help the other 99% of the people that's on Wall Street, okay? I mean, on Main Street. So these are the 1% that's on Wall Street, and I'm gonna call these people, like you and I that's watching this video. The chances are, if you're part of the 1%, you're probably not gonna be watching this video, okay? So that's why I'm not afraid about giving away these secrets to them, okay? So let's just say that we are part of the 99% that's on Main Street, okay? So apparently, Satoshi Nakamoto, a lot of people say he's Japanese because the name sounds Japanese, and a lot of people say it's a guy, right? I'm just gonna go out on a limb, and since nobody knows if it's a guy or a girl who it is, I'm just gonna refer to it as a chick, okay? Because I think that's way cooler than referring to it as a guy, you know? A lot of people say, hey, only guys can come up with this kind of stuff, but I think in this day and age, I think women can come up, you know, have the mindset to come up with this stuff too, okay? It's possible, you know? But hey, who's to say I'm wrong or I'm right? Nobody knows who the real identity of Satoshi Nakamoto is, so I'm gonna refer to it as a chick, okay? So this chick, Satoshi Nakamoto, she must have been working inside the banks as a somebody that has to deal with security and somebody that has very, very good computer science and mathematical skills. Otherwise, they wouldn't have come up with some of this stuff, okay? It has to be somebody that works in the finance, in the banking industry. A lot of people say that Satoshi was just probably, you know, just by accident or by luck. I don't believe that. I don't believe that anything that's revolutionary ever comes up by accident or by luck. It's because, like Mark Twain says, you know, that luck is the marriage of opportunity, is preparation meets opportunity. So somebody that was working as a cryptographer or as a computer scientist or computer security person that was very, very intelligent. There is no doubt whatsoever that Satoshi was one smart chick, okay? So what she did was she worked in here and she saw what happened with what the 1% was doing to suppress and take away power from the 99% that's on Main Street. So she thought about it and she thought about it and she kept thinking like, okay, what can we do to get rid of these? One is to get rid of these third-party people. You know, why is it possible that we can send, you know, messages, emails, text messages, pictures, live streaming, video, everything across the world to the other side of the world for free at no cost or anything? But why is it that we have to pay a fee or a transaction fee or a bank fee to send money from one person to another across the world or across the state lines or across country borders, okay? So that was one of the things that frustrated Satoshi, is that the 99% of the people have to pay these expensive bank fees to transfer money around, okay? The other thing too that was a concern for Satoshi is that why is it possible that the banks and the powers that be, the government, the man, the corporation, however you want to call it, I don't want to get all conspiracy theory here in this video, but you know, the 1% can look inside the ledger and determine how much money everybody has, how they're spending their money and everything. However, we, as you and I, as the private people, the 99% that's on Main Street, we cannot view this. We cannot see each other's accounts. We cannot see the accounts of what the president's making or how they're moving money around or what the governors are doing, what the congressmen are doing, and all the rich people are doing. So what Satoshi proposed was this, was that we take this public ledger right here and we make it public, okay? Since everybody, when we operate under this system up here, under the fiat system, the 1% system that's on Wall Street, what happens is everybody that you don't want to look at your account has the ability to look at it. Okay, what I mean by that is like the FBI can look at your bank account, the CIA, the NSA, all these Homeland Security, Immigration, IRS, the tax people, everybody that you don't like in the government has the ability to look at your bank account. Okay, and all the people that you don't mind looking at your account cannot look at it. Whereas on the 99% here, okay, we cannot do that with these people. So what happened was, what Satoshi did, I think that she did something that was brilliant, was that she made the bank ledger public, okay? So that was the first thing that she did. She made it public so that every transaction that's in the Bitcoin world that you buy, and if you buy anything or make any type of transaction with Bitcoin, it is recorded in this public ledger, okay? Now, some of you in the Bitcoin world, this public ledger that records all the Bitcoin transactions that's made between people, this Bitcoin ledger is referred to as a blockchain. Okay, let me just erase this and put it down here. Okay, bear with me here. Okay, look at that. I can't talk and write at the same time. Okay, it's called a blockchain. Yep, it's a fancy term, okay? And what happens is, the reason why it's called a blockchain is that every 10 minutes, okay? Let's just put it over here. 10 minutes. Every 10 minutes, what happens is all the transactions in the world that happen with Bitcoin. If somebody in China buys and uses a Bitcoin to buy anything or sell anything, if somebody in America and France and Europe and South America and Africa, it doesn't matter where in the world the transaction occurred. If there's a transaction that occurs that involves the use of Bitcoins, it is recorded in this block of information. Okay. Now, every 10 minutes, all these transactions are compiled and processed and recorded into this, okay? And then after 10 minutes goes by, the system allows, the Bitcoin system, the way it was set up is it allows another 10 minutes for all these computers in the world, these processors, to gather these things together and put the next block of information together in the ledger. Okay, in this public ledger called the blockchain. And then it goes on and it goes on. So every 10 minutes, you can expect that a new block of data or information that contains all the Bitcoin transactions in the world recorded on there, and it's the next one, okay? So just be patient, and I'll explain later on who is the people that's processing all this transaction information, okay? So in this just first part here, let's just wrap it up because I don't want to get too far and get you too confused. But what this payment system does is that it takes away power from the central banks and all the big banks on Wall Street and the 1% of the population that it benefits, right? By taking away their power to print money. Okay? So no longer, when you're here, you can no longer just print money at will. There's only a set number, and that's 21 million Bitcoins. There's only going to be 21 million and no more, okay? And I'll explain that in a future video why it's only 21 million. But at that point, none of these folks here can print that money no more. The second thing is that the people down here, the 99% here, like you and I, we have to work 9 to 5 every day to produce an income, to produce money, okay? Whereas these people don't. So Bitcoin eliminates that, okay? It eliminates the 1% from just sitting on their butts doing nothing and then getting paid all these millions of dollars. The other thing too is it takes away their monopoly. They can no longer control this money and this debt. When the people in the world, whoever has control of the money, they control the power. Okay, I think that some of you guys have heard of the golden rule, and they say that do unto others as you would have done unto you. I think that was like the version that was out when Moses or when the Bible was written or something like that. But in today's times, the golden rule actually means that whoever holds, whoever has the gold has the money, or whoever has the money has the power. Okay. So what Bitcoin does is it takes away the central banks and all their affiliate banks here, their ability to just print money at random without having to work for it or give value to another human being to get that money, it takes that power away from them, so they no longer control the power, and it gives it back to the 99% of the people that's on Main Street, okay? The third, the other fourth thing is that it takes away the third party. No longer do you have to waste a portion of your money going through two different third party people just for you to send me money, okay? So that's very, very important, and I hope that gives you a start in the first video here. In the next video, what I'm going to talk about is who are the people that are processing all these transactions and why are they doing it for free? Why are they turning on their computers and you know, jumping in and helping to process these Bitcoin transactions that's being used around the world? Why would someone go out of their way to go and do this for free and for nothing? Okay, so in the next video, we'll explore that. And I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any questions, if you have any comments about Bitcoin or the tools that will help you reach freedom, that's what my blog is all about. The tools and the technology and the strategies to help people find freedom in their life. Just leave a comment below this video and I'll be happy to answer it in my next video or in a future video. Thanks for watching this, and if you haven't subscribed, I invite you to go to my blog, prisonorfreedom.com/newsletter. And sign up for my Freedom newsletter, and I'll share more of this information with you in the future. Thanks for watching this video, and I'll see you in the next one.